Hi, thank you. Today's talk is not going to be a lesson, sorry. But it's going to be lessons learned from our experience working with adventure games. I come from a company based in Maribor, very small company, indie game developer. We have more people working on other projects, but we're currently four people working as a core team on games. The way we can afford to do this is by bootstrapping. So do you guys know what bootstrapping means? Yeah, so it's doing other stuff so you can do stuff that you love. So basically, my name is Tadej. I am a co-founder of our studio. My background is mostly programming, but currently I'm doing all sorts of creative and technical stuff, including story, and I got a pretty good overview of what the process of working on such a game is. So that's why I'm here today, and I'd like to share it with you. So we've been in production for more than 2 years for our adventure game, Elroy and the Aliens. And it's basically a game about a guy, a scientist, who one day, you know, he's fiddling around with his rocket, it goes up in the sky, hits something really weird happens, and off he goes, you know, on a huge adventure, beating characters, and he ends up saving the world in the end. So that's a spoiler right there. So our game, as I said, it's been in production for 2 years. This June, we went to Steam, because initially we were thinking mostly about iOS, Android, and consoles. But Steam sounded like a really great idea, and we wanted to try it out. And in a week, we got greenlit, so we're really happy about that. I'm going to show you a quick, very old teaser, if you don't mind. Narrative, which basically story, art, puzzles, development, production, and a little bit of audio as well. And actually, I wanted to start this with art and end with production. But seeing as we're 2 years in and not done yet, I wanted to end on a high note, but not a low one. So basically, I was thinking about what the entire process of making an adventure game is compared to other games. And it's basically very similar to making a cartoon or a movie, which means that you're, I wouldn't say fucked, but it basically means that you're not able to do as much parallel work as you are in other genres. So it's a very waterfall kind of oriented model. And the way I see this is that making an adventure game is like climbing a mountain. And you start, you know, by laying down the foundations of a story. Then you start, you know, doing concept art and developing characters and going to puzzles and prototypes and so on. And depending on how high on this mountain you climb, the fall, you know, can be very catastrophic or it can be mild. You know? So it's very important, even for adventure games, it's very important to prototype a lot. Once their puzzles, puzzles are designed, it's very important to get them playable very quickly. Because you know, if they suck, you only have to go back to the puzzle design, to pen and paper, and do some really rough art again and put it back in the game. Whereas you know, if you're, this is an example of a scene that we did, you know, that you completely threw away. It's just one of those scenes, you know, you sketch quickly, you have it. You try it out, it doesn't work, go the way, no biggie. But if you're higher up the mountain, like if you're already doing final art and stuff like that, and you realize that some stuff is not working, you have to go back down the chain and see, you know, which parts have to be fixed. And it can be either, you know, a fall like this that costs already, you know, quite a lot of money, or if you're really unlucky, come right back to rewriting some parts of the story, which of course happened to us as well. So this is then an example of a really finished, polished scene that was in the process of being redone right here. And when you think about production basically video games means project management. How do you manage such a project? And it's there are a lot of tools out there that you can use. But it's not always easy to apply all these tools to all the parts of making such a game. First, you know, you have all these very mysterious parts, mysterious processes like story, you know, laying down the foundations of, you know, musical themes and stuff like that. They're very creative and you don't really know, you know, how to manage such a process. I mean, there are ways, but it's not as easy for the others. And then you have the development, and then you have QA. And each of these phases has different tools that, for instance, we use. Well, you know, for the first part, it's just, you know, here be dragons. It's, you try to be done as soon as you can. You know, the best way to start working such a game is to come up with a story and then, you know, decide to start a project. The rest of the stuff, you know, you can use a lot of project management software. We like Basecamp and other stuff. And for QA, for testing, ticketing stuff, you know. But, you know, I said oftentimes that our game has been delayed a couple of times, but there's a huge, great quote by Shigeru Miyamoto, is the creator of Mario, that a delayed game is eventually good, but a rushed game is forever bad. So I really love this quote. So let's start off by talking about narrative. So what is narrative? Anyways, I mean, when we talk about narrative is basically the plot, the story, but these three terms, people like to differentiate them based on, you know, the mechanics of what it actually entails. So while the story is the sequence of events, the plot is how these events relate to each other, and the narrative is the end result of what you come up with. The narrative is the story that you write down and serves as the foundation for laying down, you know, some concept art and stuff like that. And, you know, contrary to what most people believe and what I believe as well, narrative is not, I mean, the story in the game, the narrative in the game, is not, the most important thing here is not what happens. This is not the most important thing when you're telling a story. The most important thing is how you tell it. And 90% of what gets people interested and keeps them interested in a story is how you tell it. And there people have thought about this long and far, and this is why you have so many similar movies, because, you know, somebody came up with a good formula and, you know, they just keep injecting different thematics. There are two really good books that I recommend. One is Joseph Campbell's Hero of a Thousand Faces. I think this book originates from the 50s, but it's a book that many game developers love to read, and many game writers recommend. Another book that partly derives from this one, but it's a more condensed, you know, version directed just to video games, is Video Game Storytelling, which I know recommend as well. In the first book by Joseph Campbell, what he did is he looked at, you know, old mythologies, the best stories that mankind has been telling, you know, for generations, and derived a set of rules that are common for most of them. And something that, there are many names for this, but the most popular is the hero's journey. Basically means that there's a hero, something happens to the hero, he refuses to act, somebody comes and helps him, and off he goes, you know, to the second act, to onwards on his journey. And this structure, if you keep this structure, if you understand that the character inside the story has to change and go through changes make what his motivations, her motivations, make sense to the player, then you've got something. And George Lucas, creator of Star Wars, there's a story about him struggling with the story of Star Wars. And I think he was one of the first people who, in the entertainment industry, in science fiction, you know, to get Campbell's book and, you know, start thinking about story in a way laid out in the hero's journey. And, you know, for example, if we look at the story of, how many of you have seen Star Wars from 1977? Almost everyone. Okay. So, these are, on the left, you have the structures of the hero's journey. On the right, you have what happens in Star Wars. And it's basically the same, you know. First, you have a call to adventure, Princess Leia's message, then you have a refusal of call where the hero doesn't, you know, really feel like going on that journey, and he doesn't feel like that because he wants to stay a farmer. And then you have somebody comes, either a mentor or something supernatural, and, you know, kind of provokes that journey, and that's Obi-Wan Kenobi in this case. And then you have the first threshold the hero has to pass, is, you know, leaving Tatooine. Then you have the belly of the whale, this is just a metaphor, which is the trash compactor. And then, you know, this is just the departure part of the story. Then you have the initiation, then you have the return, and all these pieces, you know, it's worthwhile studying them, because, you know, even if you're working on a really, really simple game, it makes sense to keep a structure that makes sense to somebody who's playing it. Another thing that really makes sense to keep in mind is character arcs. Character arcs are the process of how characters within the process of the whole story change. So, you know, when you have the hero going through different phases of the story, there's different things that happen to the hero, and they have to affect the hero somehow. Otherwise, you just stop caring about the main character. And of course, there's different types. You know, you have the rise and fall, the change, the transformation, stuff like that. But that's something that you guys can definitely read up more about. One important thing I read a couple of great article on Gama Sutra about emotional alignment. It's a series about game design, and I think this was the highlight. And it's talking about how, of course, you have the hero going through changes. The hero at each point has certain motivations. Hero starts off with a strong motivation, you know, goes, something happens, there's different motivation. You have to make, you have to keep in mind that the motivation of the player has to be aligned with the motivation of the main character, which basically means everything the main character is doing or wants to do has to make sense to somebody who's playing the game. One thing that's, that it's funny that I wanted to mention this, but this me. TV shows are something that's usually looked down upon. So you look at TV, you watch TV, you know, you have all these series and in all these episodes, you know, the same stuff happens over and over again. It's just the patterns that are repeating, like trouble follows you home. You go somewhere, you do something, somebody sees you, you see something you weren't supposed to see. You go home not knowing that something that somebody saw you, and then they're waiting for you at home. Stuff like that. I just wanted to mention this. There's a great website with a huge list of these TV shows that it's very helpful to look at these, because if you're not, you know, if you haven't been writing for 50 years or something like that, you know, it's very, very useful to look at these tropes and see, you know, what are some of these patterns that are working. And how could they work inside the game? Has anybody seen Tomorrowland? What do you think about it?
Challenging,
okay, yeah. But what about the story itself, the narrative?
It wasn't bad for me. It was entertaining.
Yeah, yeah.
It special.
Nothing special.
Yeah.
Okay, but it was supposed to be really special, I think, the movie itself. I mean, I love the first...
It was a good twist, yeah.
Yeah, I like that too. But do you know who the main character is in the story?
It's all three of them.
Yeah, that's but isn't that weird that all three are the main character? No? I mean, to me, and I was reading you know, some response. I mean, the score for the movie is 6-something on IMDb.
Really?
Yeah. And I was reading some reviews and a great analysis by great game designer called Jesse Schell. He talked about Tomorrowland and how the story, he really loved the theme, like I did. You know, the first part of the movie I loved, you know, I wanted to be in the movie. But then at some point, the story a little bit, got a little bit wonky, stopped making sense a little. Not in a sense of being illogical, but you lose the sight of who is the main character, and which character is the one who is affected by changes. And in the end, you know which character goes through most changes in the movie? It's the girl.
Which one?
The robot.
The robot?
Yeah. Sorry for spoilers. they can cut it out from the video. I mean, for good examples of good story structure, you can look at The Last of Us. It's a great game. You can look at Star Wars. I mean, Star Wars is pretty simple, straightforward, but it gets the job done. When you think about the process of how you go about writing narrative and how to place it within the entire, you know, cycle of making the game, is you start off with a basic plot. You derive characters and locations from that. Then you go, you know, further, write down the narrative. Develop the locations, develop the characters, and then you go off to storyboarding. And after storyboarding, storyboarding can result storyboarding is followed by puzzles, by prototypes of puzzles. You have, you know, the entire story also generates dialogue, you know, but you have placeholder dialogue at this point. And when you start developing all this, you can slowly go into a beta of a game. So this is it in a nutshell from our perspective. And this is kind of like our storyboards, what our storyboards look like. It's just, you know, pieces of paper, like a comic strip with pictures and some text that helps understand what's going on. And wanted to just mention quickly exposition. Exposition in a story or a movie or a game is the act of explaining background information. So exposition usually gets run through cutscenes, or you know, or something you read in a terminal, similarly. In adventure games, we love to see exposition done through gameplay or through short dialogue, because cutscenes tend to take you away from the action and tend to add some artificial feeling, you know, to the entire experience. Just wanted to mention this. Of course, we have cutscenes in our game, but we try to minimize that. One important thing, any of you programmers? Yeah? No one? Yeah, a couple of people. So in programming, we have a thing called technical debt. So it's when you're working on something and you have two ways of doing it. It's the right way or the quick way, and you do it the quick way. And then you do another thing and you do that the quick way, and you do another thing and do that right. And in the end, you know, it keeps, you know, biting you in the behind. And funnily, you know, similar thing happens in the story about writing. When you're working, you know, all these boxes are different parts of the story. And some of these make sense. There's one of those that you call placeholder. So here I'm going to have somebody who comes and arranges that the main character will be motivated to do something. And you just keep it like that, maybe you refine it a little, maybe you make it funny, but it doesn't make sense in the whole structure. And what happens, you know, we call it, we'll rewrite later, you know, the boss. But actually, you won't, because what usually happens is that the next part, you were writing this, and the next part, you didn't even realize, at some point started depending on this part, and then, you know, slowly the entire thing starts crumbling, and then in the end, even the beginning doesn't make sense anymore. So this is why it's very important to go slow with some things, and unless you're a genius writing stories. So, but when good things happen, you know, you get ideas, you know, we came up with a font for the video game, we have an alien script that we can use and make the whole world richer, and just, you know, send secret messages across the office, kind of thing. But the next thing, you know what, you have the story, you have some of these things, but arguably, one of the most important things in adventure games are the puzzles, because that's why you're basically playing it, apart from learning what's going to happen. And there are several puzzle types that are usually present in adventure games. There's the inventory puzzle, where you grab a thing, combine it with another thing, and come up with something else. Or get a key, put it in the lock, unlock the door, unbar the door, go through. There's environmental puzzles. That's, you know, you have a space, and the character is walking around the space and is making changes to the space, you know, to make something environmental happen. Then there's dialogue puzzles, which is basically talking to other characters, trying to convince them or get information. We try to minimize those because they're kind of old school, and people mobile don't tend to be very patient. But we still have them and we still like them. And there's also non-contextual puzzles, logical puzzles. And these are basically, you know, when you get a full screen puzzle that you have to solve and it doesn't have much to do with the rest of the game, but it serves as a way of, you know, adding difficulty and also, you know, as a brain teaser that you kind of can also get satisfaction from. So, here's an example of such a puzzle, we call it a full screen puzzle. Here's an environmental puzzle from our game, you know, where you manipulate the environment to get through the door. And here's an example of an inventory puzzle as well. There's a thing that I think first Ron Gilbert came up with, or at least, you know, put it like that, as a puzzle dependency chart. I like this. I mean, it's very useful when designing puzzles. When I'm sitting down with, you know, pen and paper, You know, when you think about what you want the player to do, you start off with what the end result is. So the end result in this case, I understand exclusively, sorry, is fly away in a spaceship. So what you have to do to be able to fly away in a spaceship, this is not an example from our game. So you have to, for example, you have to get three things. You have to fix the engine, you have to get some rocket fuel, you have to get navigation charts so you know where you're going. And to fix the engine, you have to get a wrench and a screwdriver. The screwdriver is easy, you pick it up. The wrench, there's an elephant sitting on it, you have to catch a mouse and get the elephant to move. And for the rest, you know, maybe you know you have a metal detector. You waited around in the garden, you find a wedding ring. There's somebody who lost the wedding ring. They give you a baseball card and rocket fuel, and you can use, you know, that to get the navigation charts. So that's an example of puzzle dependency chart. It's pretty, it's not that complicated, but it's branched out. And usually the main negative comments about old school adventure games were that, you know, the wedding ring was on this side of the map, whereas, you know, the screwdriver was like 17 screens away, so that's what usually happened. And we tried to modernize our approach in minimizing that as well, so that gameplay length does not depend solely on you walking from one part to the other. In terms of the overall process, the production, where this fits is after you have environmental concept art, and you can sketch the puzzle down on paper. You get placeholder art done, so it's basically, you know, just sketches with a pencil, scanned, you know, cut, so that they can be inserted in the game engine. You build a prototype, and then of course you test the prototype with actual people. And if the test fails, you go back to pen and paper. It's very, you know, you haven't lost more than a couple of hours or days doing all that. And if it succeeds, you can go on and polish the puzzle. So let's talk a little bit about art. There's in adventure games nowadays, there's several different approaches. You have pure 2D, which we're doing basically with some other additions. You have 3D, like Grim Fandango 3D, or there's also all kinds of 3D adventure games. But you also have 2D with a 3D pipeline, which is, do you guys know Broken Age? Yeah, so Broken Age actually uses, everything looks 2D, but the process they use is they can use a team who used to work on 3D projects, because they're using Maya, they're using all these 3D tools, and skeletal animations, but it's all just flat. So that's a good idea as well, but it doesn't allow you to do everything. Here are some of the tools. Urban over there, he's our art director, he can talk more about this. But basically pen and paper, TV paint for animation, Photoshop, cameras. You know, I saw Urban, that was a year ago, but or more, I saw him, you know, I was looking where he is, went outside the office and he was, you know, jumping, you know, and filming himself, and it was really funny because he wanted to get down, you know, the movements and try to copy them in a way that would make sense for the main character. Of course, we use Photoshop scripts, you know, to make stuff easier, and we use Unity and artists use Unity as well. So here's an example working in TVPaint, working on a sketch animation. Some examples of one of our offices, the walls are full of concept art. A lot of this stuff doesn't make any sense in the game. It's just, you know, stuff that helps us get a feeling, get some ideas, get inspiration. There's some more concept art, sketched as well in black and white. Here's a scene that's almost what's done, if you ask me, but he would disagree. And this one as well. And the pipeline for the art, from the artist's point of view, basically is you get the narrative, you work on concept art, you work on characters, and the person designing the puzzles if they're working on non-contextual puzzles, like those full screen things, they don't need much from the artist. But if they're working on something that has to fit into the environment, it's very useful to build a scene, just a sketch of a scene, so or and a map, so you know where you are and you have a easier, you know, way of figuring out how to design the puzzle. And this is an example that's also, none of this is actually has made it to the final version, but it's an example of how you can construct a map so that it helps the puzzle designer think about you know, different ideas. And we can also talk a little bit about animation. We opted for 2D hand-drawn animation for most stuff, which means like Disney style, you know, drawing frame by frame. But for some things like robots and stuff, we use a skeletal approach or just animation in Unity. Now I'm going to show you a short video of what the animation process looks like. Station indicates I'm going to talk a little bit about development. There are a couple of engines that are currently out there that work really well for adventure games as well. For some pixel arty, really great games like the Blacklist series, Captain Babylon, people like to use Adventure Game Studio, which is very much suited for such a game. We love Unity, we've used it from the past, we built our own framework for adventure games. There are other frameworks out there for Unity right now that are available in the App Store, so if you're interested in that, I encourage you to seek them out. This is kind of like what a C looks like in Unity for us. Basically, what you can see underneath is it's a flat scene. We use orthogonal projection. We don't use 3D space to help us with parallax. We calculate the parallax ourselves. We just that's something we went through the process of using 3D distance to make parallax happen. But it is in the end, it was too much of a hassle for when designing the scene. Here's I don't know how familiar you are with how these things work. It's pretty simple stuff. It's how you get, you have a scene that's tilted a certain way, and the tilt will kind of define what size the character will be at each point of the scene on the Y axis. And it's a very simple linear interpolation, calculation. You have a max size, a minimum size, and the two endpoints. navigation, you know, where the character can walk, is something that we made easier for us, you know, working on some tools for Unity. And you can draw in the scene, the artist can draw, you know, the path along which the character is able to walk. And with the character is walking, based on the velocity, the current velocity of the character, you calculate which sprite is used, you know, to know where the character is facing. Here's, you know, kind of, you know, what a setup of a character will look like. You have, you know, the mouth, different mouths, different eyes. The character, you know, has different eyes based on the emotion, and different you know, mouth shapes based on what they're saying and all that. And the head itself is just a quick example of what it consists of. So you can get an idea, you know, what's possible with such a setup. The pupils can move. So, you know, when our character talks, it just doesn't just move the mouth. It also moves the eyebrows up and down, you know, in a certain, you know, kind of random. There's a algorithm to it, but there's a certain amount of randomness. It feels more natural. And also the pupils will move a little bit. Here are all the directions the character can face. Of course, some of them can be mirrored. So overall, you have the backside is missing. When you work on these animations, when all these animations are in place and you try to, you know, connect them in a game engine, you get a giant mess. You know, this is the web of the main character's animation from, I think, a year ago. And it's the next version of Unity is coming up with some stuff that makes this not necessary. But version 4.6, this is the only way you can do it. One interesting thing I think here is talking about lip sync, how we do it. Because when the character talks, the lips have to move with it. And in 3D, you have all these algorithms. You know, you have the mesh. You define the mesh, you define the mesh of the mouth, and you have libraries that make it easy for you to automatically sync and then make corrections. We have to do it ourselves for 2D, of course. There's this thing I wanted to mention is the Braxton Blair phoneme set. There's one term here called the viseme. The phoneme is what you hear, it's the sound. The viseme is the shape of the mouth. And the thing is that most of the sounds have a pair that looks kind of the same when you look at the mouth only. And that's why you don't have to recreate every possible sound. You can group certain sounds together, like A and I, and for instance, and so forth. Underneath you can see the mouth shapes animating. It's kind of like it looks in our engine. And the way we go about writing what the characters are saying, we use a Google spreadsheet. We enter, you know, each line for each character. Each character has a code. Each line has a code, and each line also has an emotion, a mood. So that then affects how the actor is going to say the words, and also how the character is going to behave saying them. So roughly the process, we get the rough script. We use text-to-speech engine to get a rough, you know, approximately a robot voice in the game, for the entire game. This one we can use for the alpha. This kind of, you know, for the technical people, how we do it in the back end. We do it automatically with the Google API. Then you get, you work on the final script, hire voice actors. Voice actors come back with WAV files in a format that you want. You can use speech recognition to kind of predetermine how the mouth shapes are going to look. But it's very precise when you do that, so you have to do manual fixes before you're going to beta. And this is a tool that we use for manual fixes. Papagaya, it's open source. One final thing in development I wanted to mention is hint systems. You often have a adventure game where you have a question mark and you press it, and screen pops up, and you know, you can get a stage explanation of what can be done or can't be done. Machinarian has a way of giving you hints, but doesn't where it doesn't allow you to stay ahead until you've completed an action game or a puzzle or something like that. But we think that it's the best way of giving hints is through the game itself, by the character actually pointing you in the right direction and other characters pointing you in the right direction. Devil Tentacle is one example of a great game that does this perfectly. Voice recording, another thing. We use a company for that. Actors, auditions, and then we get back a lot of audition files and use that to make a selection. But there are also a lot of, for games that don't have a lot of voice, there are a lot of services like Fiverr, Voice Bunny, you know, 123 Voice, that are cheaper. But the important thing to keep in mind is that when these people, when you hire people across the world to do your voices, because you need native speakers, this is a must, you know, people will hear it if they're not. When you hire people to do the voices and they each use different equipment, it's going to sound shit. And it's, you know, I played a game the other day, you talk to one person and they have a perfect voice, you talk to the other person, it sounds like Skype. So it doesn't really work. It's one of those things that really makes sense, keeping in mind, I think. For sounds, we use placeholders at first, just go, you know, to freesound.com or whatever the site is called. Layer points, we try to, you know, for the sounds that are not that, you know, special in the game, you know, we try to use a licensed sounds as well. We have to pay for them, but it's pretty cheap. But for the stuff that really has to pop, you know, it makes sense doing a lot of big custom sound effects. For music, there's music is very important in such a game because it kind of gives you the mood. I mentioned a little bit about the process earlier that coming up with a theme is something that's not as easy. But later on, you know, there's a system that's 20 years old already by LucasArts called Scum, and it still works well. It's not something you can use, but you can copy the behavior, which is basically having a smaller number of themes and variations based on the context of the game. Here's our guy, Martin. This is our great music partner, Martin Epix Productions. Plays in a great band as well, and here's Martin, who wrote all our music, or at least most of it, in the studio. And I said I was going to end on a high note, because the secret ingredient. Right, guys. Thanks. Any questions? I'm happy to answer. Wishful thinking would be Q1 next year.
Since you were primarily developing for time-based devices, and then you ported into PC, so you could Steam.
Yeah.
Would you do any like special adaptations, so it doesn't feel like a mobile port or something that is fits on a PC?
Okay, for the sake of the recording, I'll just repeat that we started working on touch devices, aiming it for touch devices, porting it to PC. Are we doing any adaptations for it to make sense? Most of our puzzles and the gameplay work really well with the mouse. We developed with the mouse, we tested with the mouse. The added benefit of having retina screens everywhere means that the resolution of the iPad is higher than the resolution of the PC that people play on usually. So we don't have to make higher res graphics because we're already there. We'll definitely think about if there's anything creative we're going to add to the actual Steam version, or if it's just technical stuff. Because there's a lot of technical things we need to take care of, and also be able to cater to all these different versions of the platform. So yeah, but we're not quite there yet to make that decision. So don't hold on.
What's the overall budget for this kind of game?
I would rather not say, but it's quite high. We had to definitely work for almost 2 years to get to that kind of budget. So, yeah.
How many people did work on this project?
As I said earlier, the core team is four, and two more helped.
Not including other studios that helped us and such.
How do you mean?
Voice actors and...
Not including these, yes. I don't include them currently, but there's a strike. Voice actors are having a strike in the US, so I please delete this scene. The core team is four. The project for a team of that size is very ambitious. We know that, but there's a game. I have to plug them because I really like the game. The Journey Down. By a Swedish team, three guys making a game of a similar scale. So I that's encouraging, at least. Yeah. Yeah.
How long does it take to make those hand-drawn animations that you show? So is it hours or days?
Days, definitely weeks. Yeah, I mean, that's my experience. You can ask about that later. But it's usually weeks for like a walk cycle. That can be done in a week. I mean, it can be done now that we have a style and all that, but it's something that takes a while. We tried using Spriter, that's kind of a skeletal based 2D animation tool. We used it for a run animation, and the run animation done in Spriter is in our old trailer. And we started hating it, you know, like after a couple of months we started hating it and we redrew everything by hand. So
how are adventure games trending lately?
Currently, not bad. They were reawakened by the Kickstarter boom a little bit, Broken Age and everything that started going on then. I think touch devices helped a lot, and also the trend away from hidden object games, because hidden object games are really, really popular, and for people who don't mind a little bit more of gameplay than the mechanics of hidden object games, I think it's a good transition. But all in all, I think the number of people liking and playing adventure games has always been significant. But it's the number of people playing other games that's risen, I think. And currently we're pretty positive in this regard.
And are the results that people actually earning money, because there's been a lot of loss in games?
Yeah, I mean, it depends on what you're aiming for. If you want to get millions, then maybe you have to be lucky. But there's a great studio in New York called Wajitai Games. Make the Black Bull series. They publish Techno Babylon. They have other games as well. And they're doing pretty well. Doing just pixel art adventure games. Really classical style. With a lot of dialogue, a lot of talking, and aiming for an even smaller audience than probably we are.
How do you get in touch with people to test the concepts in the game so that they don't suck, that they're okay from there?
Yeah, we do a lot of that ourselves, within the team, and also with people who don't work on the project. We go to events, we get in touch with people, different communities, and have a mailing list of beta testers for later stages. But it's not always easy to get people in, to get people in the same room and get great results if they haven't worked with you before.
How do you prototype?
Prototyping works just writing dirty code upon dirty art and putting it in the game.
Yeah, no paper.
Yeah, paper prototyping. I mean, all the puzzles are designed on paper, so the stages are on paper, and somebody can look at them and try to solve them. So even if it's a logical puzzle, you can try to like it's something you need to rotate. You need to rotate this disc and that disc. You can come up with a certain rotation and show it to somebody and for them to figure out what the solution is. So this is also a good stage to test some concepts. Okay, thank you guys.